Good evening, everyone. My name is John Hughes, and I'm the music director of the Chicago Master Singers, and it is my honor to welcome you to another session of CMS University. I'm glad you're here and part of this online community that we've been building since our very first CMSU session back in August. Now, one of the ways that we've been doing that is through the chat window on the right-hand side of your screen. So take a second, make sure you're logged into YouTube, and then you can join the conversation. You can even ask me a question, as long as you're watching this live on Monday evening. Just make sure you start that with three or four question marks in a row, and then I can quickly distinguish what's intended for me. And as time allows, I'll put your questions up on the screen and try my best to answer them. Everyone is welcome to participate in the chat window. Doesn't matter if you're a CMS member or just checking us out, you are welcome here. Okay, our topic for tonight is the making of a modern edition. And this might seem like a little bit of an odd, maybe esoteric topic, but I think it's really interesting, and it's something I've spent a lot of time working on. And I'll be talking about my work creating a modern edition throughout this evening. One of the things that I want you to think about right away is that often we think about choral music and conductors being very public-facing, right? They are doing rehearsals and they're doing concerts, talking to the audience, right? And that is definitely part of the job. But one thing that I want you to take away from is that a lot of conducting is also very solitary, right? And if you watched my presentation earlier this year on the conductor silent process, right? You'll know all the score study that we put into music. And this is a similar side of this career in that it's a very scholarly approach too. And that's really this kind of dualistic career path of being very scholarly and individual work, as well as the public facing music man. I think that's why I get so much joy out of music, because I can kind of use both sides of my personality and brain in this career. So I hope that this maybe gives you a little insight into some of the other work I do besides just waving my arms. So I'm going to start by showing you an example here of a piece of Renaissance music that I'm assuming most of you are familiar with, and that is the wonderful Tudor anthem, If You Love Me by Thomas Tallis. Now, what you're seeing here is a manuscript from the mid-16th century, and this is from a choir book. So, or a part book, you might have heard that as well. And you'll notice a few things right away. First of all, it's not a score. This is only the alto part. Now, it's kind of like in band or something where if you play clarinet, you get a clarinet part, right? You don't get the full score. That's how choral music was for a long time. So you'll notice If You Love Me kind of starts on the third staff, and it followed. That piece above it is a completely different anthem, right? And so this was an alto part book, and then there was a tenor part book and a bass part book and a soprano part book, right? So you'll notice that it's very different than the way we would see music. You'll also notice that in this piece, there's not a time signature. There's something called C slash in the margin there. That's really a mensuration sign. We won't get into all of that. That's a totally different topic, but not a formal time signature that we think of today, but you should just be aware that the whole note is getting the beat. The other things to notice, voice-specific clef, right? Normally altos today read in treble clef. Here it's in alto clef. You'll notice there are no measure lines at all, right? So this is one of the distinctive features of Renaissance music, is it feels meterless in a way. And then the last thing to notice is that there's a repeat sign here, right? Right after the word comforter, there's a repeat sign, and that produces an A, B, B form, which is very typical of Tudor anthems. So even though many of us have sung If You Love Me many, many times, I know my wife and I had it sung at our wedding. It's a really lovely piece. I'm guessing most of us did not sing it from something like this, right? And that really gets to my fundamental question of this evening, which is, how do choral scholars like myself take a manuscript from the 16th century that's in part books and put it in a format that works for modern ensembles like today. I'm going to start by showing you three possible solutions to this "If Ye Love Me." So here's number one. Now you'll notice this is actually in the same key as the original one. So this is in C major. And that is maybe a little problematic for modern ensembles because you'll notice it's very low, right? The upper two voices are treble clef, but down an octave, the way maybe tenors might read today. And then the lower parts are in bass clef. So this might be best sung by an AATB choir or ATBB choir even. So maybe not the easiest for a modern SATB ensemble that's of mixed voices to work, but it maintains that. Now it does do something that's very common in choral music, and it reduces the note values. So instead of the whole note being the beat, the half note is the beat. We also see measure lines added, which is nice in a way because then we can say, okay, let's start at measure 7, right? We know where that is, but it diminishes the authenticity. We also see ties over the bar line on the word me, which if we go back to this manuscript, we don't see that on the word me, right? That's a dotted whole note. So here, that tie over the bar line reinforces that this is a modern edition, that it isn't authentic to how the manuscript actually looked. You'll also notice some editorial suggestions. There's a tradition of kind of saying commandments, and so the editor added that little dotted figure to say, that's okay, you might do that. So this is one possible solution. Here's another one, completely different editor, and they made some different choices. So first of all, they transposed the part up a perfect fourth into F major. This then makes it more accessible to SATB ensembles as we know it today. I actually don't have a big problem with transposition. As I've talked about throughout the CMSU, in particular the session on how to approach music from different time periods, remember pitch is very flexible, right? The whole idea of A equaling 440 is relatively new. So this doesn't really bother me that it's transposed. And frankly, if I were doing this piece, F major is notoriously difficult to stay in tune in. So I might say, okay, it's notated in F, but I'm gonna give you an E to start it. So even there, where it's transposed doesn't really matter, except for the rehearsal pianist who needs that, needs to know what key to play it in. Other notable characteristics here are that there are no time signature or measure lines, which preserves the overall kind of meterless quality of the piece, but maybe makes it a little difficult to rehearse from because you just have to say, okay, where the tenors do this, right? The final thing is that it does reduce the note values, which is kind of interesting, right? Like they do so much to keep the authenticity, no measure lines, etc. It really looks like a Renaissance piece. But then they diminish the note values, probably because it's easier for us to think of the half note being the beat than the whole note being the beat. But that's just kind of an interesting choice that this editor made. All right, the final possible solution for If You Love Me is here. This is transposed up a major third, again, to accommodate SATB ensembles. And here we see kind of a more modern time signature, which is 4-2. So the whole note is still getting the beat, I guess, unless someone's thinking of conducting this in 4. I would personally rather, if you're going to use a modern time signature, see this notated as 2-1. So two beats per bar with the whole note getting the beat. So I kind of have some quibbles with this time signature. This retains the original note values, which is great to see. And they came up with a solution that I like very much, which is the little tick lines where the measure lines would appear. These then allow you to have measure numbers and to clearly see where the measures fall, but they're not distracting. They still have this quality of being out of the way. You're not noticing the measure lines in the way you typically would. That said, it is a little confusing then that they used ties on that word me again. That tie just kind of diminishes the authenticity of the addition. Now, I understand why they did it. Anyone who's ever used Finale or Sibelius or any other music notation software knows that it can be very difficult. You have to basically trick it to allow you to have too many beats in the measure. So they didn't do that. And I think this edition maybe suffers a little bit from that. So now we're gonna, now that you kind of have the lay of the land, right? I'm gonna talk the majority of this evening about the St. John Passion by Leonard Lechner, which was composed in 1593. This is the piece that I wrote my doctoral dissertation on. And my dissertation was not a modern edition. It was a long paper about an analysis of the piece. But since completing my doctorate, I've created a modern edition. And I'm basically going to take you through how I did that and the decisions I made. Because I think the main thing to remember tonight is that there's really no one right answer, right? Making an edition is a series of judgments, and it really depends on what the goal of your edition is, right? If the goal is, I want to make this super accessible for any modern day choir, the resulting edition will look different than if your goal is, I want to make this as authentic and absolutely pristine as possible. Well, those are going to look very different. So I'm just going to tell you a little bit about my work and the decisions I made and the reasoning behind it. So let me start by just giving you a little background about Lechner himself. Roughly 1553, we're not exactly sure, to 1606. He grew up singing as a choir boy under the very famous Orlandus Lassus, who, you know, is up there with Palestrina in terms of really being a master of Renaissance polyphony. So he had a pretty prestigious musical upbringing. He held many notable musical positions throughout his career, but really spent the majority of his music-making life in Württemberg, in the Duchy of Württemberg, which is kind of like a state, which is centered in Stuttgart, Germany. And eventually he became the Hofkapellmeister, so in charge of all the chapel music there. Now, this Passion setting from 1593 is frequently cited as being one of the most important Passion settings prior to those of J.S. Bach. That's really saying something, right? We think of Bach's St. John and St. Matthew Passions as really being some of the highest level of choral writing. So to equate Lechner's with that is really interesting. So a couple overall things about Lechner's Passion. First of all, the key to understanding this piece is that it was written in Württemberg, in Stuttgart, the capital of Württemberg. And Württemberg is in southwest Germany. So that is a traditionally Catholic area, even to this day, right? We think of northern Germany as being primarily Protestant, southern Germany as being more Catholic. And so it's really unique that Württemberg accepted Lutheranism in 1535, very shortly after the Reformation really took hold. And that makes it in a precarious position here. Now, Lechner's Passion really demonstrates both Lutheran elements and Catholic ones. And this is not all that surprising, right? When a duchy like Württemberg accepted Lutheranism, it didn't just throw out all its Catholic traditions. Rather, they really were merged and blended. So in the Lutheran side, we have elements like it's a completely biblical text in German, right? So that clearly resounds with the principles of Luther's Reformation. We see very clear text setting. It's not all the melismas that we might associate with other Renaissance music, right? You can actually really clearly understand the words. And then finally, there was this idea of expressive writing. And this was really focused on Christ's suffering, the passages in the Passion about the nails and the crown of thorns, that was supposed to kind of engender more devotion in the listener. So those are kind of the Lutheran elements. On the other hand, we have Lechner integrating the passion tones. And I'll define those in a little bit. But basically, you have to realize that these passion tones are developed from years of Catholic liturgy. And Lechner integrates them directly into his passion. And that's what makes his passion so special, is that he integrates this existing material into his freely composed, his newly composed long motet, and it sounds seamless, and that's really his compositional genius. And I'll talk about what the passion tones are in a minute, but just in general, this kind of bifurcated Lutheran and Catholic influences on his passion setting are a direct outgrowth of the liturgical and political and cultural climate in Stuttgart at the time. Okay, so the source manuscript. What did I use to create this passion setting? Well, Lechner's original 1593 manuscript doesn't exist that we know of. The 1594 publication doesn't exist. Rather, what you're looking at here is a 16th century choir book that was made in Württemberg, but then owned by the Kassel Hofkapelle. And this book is still held in Kassel at a university library there. One kind of Lechner's passion, and might have even sung it from this particular choir book, right? So again, we see the lineage is not as diverse as one might think. It really is very small circle there. So prior to the edition that I've produced, there have been two other modern editions. The first one in 1926 by Otto Cade, and then in 1960 by Conrad Allman, which is pictured here. This is actually part of a 12-volume set, The Collected Works of Leonard Lechner. So that just kind of signifies his stature in choral music. And so this 1960 edition is really important. So let me just show you a little bit about it. And I'm seeing in the chat that there's some technical stuff. I'm sorry, I don't know. My end, it seems to be going fine. So we'll just push through and hopefully it corrects itself again. So a little bit about the Allman edition here. This reduces the original note values. So much like the Talus version, the whole note would be getting the beat. Here, Allman reduces everything in half. And so then it becomes the half note getting the beat. He uses a technique called Mensurstrich, which is where the measure lines are between the staves rather than through the measures. This then allows the sight picture to remain unbroken by measure lines, but the measure lines are there just in between the staves for ease of rehearsal, right? So this is a very common practice in Renaissance music editing. Allman also modernizes the German text, uses and kind of standardizes the punctuation and everything. Which is not standard in the manuscript. Finally, and probably most frustratingly, there is no indication in Allman's edition of the passion tones, which is like the whole point of Lechner's passion. Without the passion tones, it would be a 40-minute motet telling the story of Christ's crucifixion. But the passion tones are really what makes it so interesting, and there's not any indication of that. So that's a little frustrating. So let me tell you a little bit about my edition, which I completed and is set to be published sometime soon. Hopefully, it's been delayed because of the pandemic, and hopefully it'll be out soon. And let me tell you a little bit about it. I have kind of three overarching principles that I tried to accomplish. The first thing I did, though, was create an editorial policy. So I had to figure out, how am I going to deal with sign changes? You know, at the beginning of the piece, it's in C slash, that kind of two whole notes per bar feel. But sometimes he switches into a triple meter. So how are you going to accommodate that? Sometimes he has sharps or flats in the score. Sometimes it's kind of, I can infer that there should be a sharp or a flat there just based on what's happening musically. But for whatever reason, it wasn't included in the manuscript. So then how do you notate that? Like I mentioned, the punctuation, spelling, syllabification is all over the place. Even in the same part, on the same page, Jesus will be broken one time, J-E-S-U-S, and then the next time, J-E-S-U-S. So then I have to decide, am I going to represent it the way it is in the source manuscript, or am I going to standardize it, and which way am I going to standardize it, right? So lots of little decisions in that. There's also ligatures, which are like combinations of two notes that have their roots in Gregorian chant. So you have to figure out, how are you going to represent that in a modern score, right? And a lot of this really comes down to tricking Finale, is the program that I use, into allowing you to do all these crazy things and have too many beats per measure and everything else. So like I said, I have three main goals when I made this edition. The first is to balance authenticity with modern convenience. I wanted to keep it authentic and kind of true to the source material, but I didn't want it to be so esoteric that no one would ever sing from it, right? My goal is that people will actually perform this piece, so I want to give them a performance score that has a lot of scholarship behind it. So some of the things I did, I kept the original note values, the whole note equals the beat, and I use C slash as the time signature. But I also use that tick mark idea that is like what we saw in one of the solutions for the Talus manuscript. But I did not use ties, and I'll show you what that looks like in a minute. And I use modern clefs and measure numbers. So here is an example of I just picked a random page from the Lechner manuscript. You'll notice that the soprano and tenor are on facing pages with the alto and bass. The clefs here, the soprano is actually in treble clef, so that is a G, right? Showing you where the G line is. The alto, that is a C clef, saying that that second line from the bottom is middle C. The tenor is in what we would call alto clef, where the middle line is middle C. And the bass is in an F clef, but on the wrong line, or a different line than what we would use today. And that's saying that that middle line is the F below middle C. So you can tell why I wanted to use modern clefs. So this is what the original manuscript would look like, or does look like, right? And here's what my modern edition of the same passage looks like. Ah, right? A little bit easier to kind of see what's going on. So you can see here, measure numbers, modern clefs like we use in choral music today. The tick marks allow you to have this feeling of being unmeasured, but are there. And so then you could say, okay, in measure 21, right? And we know where that is. Some other things that are just kind of interesting here is measure 20 in the bass part has too many beats in it, right? It should have two whole notes, but we have this extra half note, right? So some editors might have, on the word, the first syllable of Purpur Clyde, the purple robe, right? They would make that the first note a half note tied over the bar line to another half note. And this then involved me tricking the program into letting me put that whole note there and then leaving a blank where to show that that whole note extends over the bar line, right? But then it really does give you this meterless quality, which is kind of the whole point of Renaissance music. The other kind of interesting thing that's happening in this particular system is the E flats. So you'll notice in the soprano and tenor, there are E flats here. That's because they appear in those parts, right? So if you look here at the soprano and tenor parts, you'll notice the E flats there. But those aren't, I put those in the score because that's where they are. I put it actually in the staff, right? The alto part, though, in that same part, measure 21, if you look in that equivalent on the manuscript, there is not an E flat there. And so I, as the editor, said, well, it's got to be an E flat, right? Because there's all these other E flats going on at the moment. I don't, you know, this is 16th century polyphony. We're not going to have multiple keys going on, right? So that should be an E flat. But what I did is put that flat above the alto part to say, to indicate this should probably be an E flat, but that's John Hughes saying that, not Leonard Lechner, right? So, and really remember, we have to remember this is kind of once removed from Lechner because it was produced by a scribe in Württemberg, right? This manuscript that we're looking at is not in Lechner's hand. So again, I'm trying to balance, how can I be helpful to you so that modern performers can actually do this piece while maintaining some authenticity of what this actually looked like to someone in the 16th century. Okay, let's go on to my second big goal for this is to distinguish the reconstructed parts. And let me just start, I'm gonna actually go here. You'll notice that the soprano, this is the very beginning of the piece. Very first page, soprano and tenor got ripped, who knows when, and it's not there anymore, right? So what do you do? Those notes are just gone to history. Well, what's happened is in the previous modern editions, the 1926 one by Cade, the 1961 by Allman, they looked at the other existing parts, what they can glean from the tenor, the entire alto, the entire bass, and then they reconstructed the soprano part and whatever is missing in the tenor part. And, you know, that makes sense, right? You're trying to fill out the chords, the harmonies. You can kind of figure it out. And it's only a couple measures in modern notation, right? So they this is a very common practice of reconstructing parts that are missing. And that's just part of choral scholarship. My issue with it, though, is that in the 1926 and 1960 edition, there is not an acknowledgement that these are not authentic to the manuscript, right? They're just in there with the rest of the notes. And I really wanted to distinguish, okay, these notes we know were written in the 16th century, and these other ones we've added later on to fill out the piece. So the way that I did that in my modern edition is here. I put all of the notes that I can see in that manuscript in regular typeface. And you'll notice there are some tenor notes because you can actually see some tenor notes here, right? So those are in regular typeface, as are all the notes in the alto and bass parts. The soprano part and the parts of the tenor that are missing that were reconstructed by Cade and Allman are then in this lighter face so that you can still perform them, right? If you were performing this, you could still sing those notes, but you would know as a musician and scholar that that these are not native to that manuscript. So that was really important to me. You also notice, just as an aside, an editorial thing here, that to the left of the first system here, we have these little incipit clefs, right, which are showing what is in the manuscript. So even though I put this in modern notation in terms of clefs, the two treble clefs for soprano, alto, the tenor part is in a treble clef but down an octave, and then the bass is in a bass clef. You'll see that I notated the clefs and signs, and even the two B flats in the bass part here. So just to, again, recognize this is how it actually looked, but I want you to perform this, so I'm putting it here. Okay, the last thing here, and then I'll take your questions. So put as many questions as you want here, and I'll get to them in a minute. The last thing that I really wanted to do is clearly identify the passion tones, because there's a very famous book by Basil Smallman about the history of the passion before Bach. It's a great book. Lechner's name is all over it. And everyone always says, oh, Lechner's Passion, that's the one that uses the passion tones. But no one ever really explains what the passion tones are, or let alone how Lechner used the passion tones in his Passion, right? It's just kind of like, oh, that's what that piece is known for. And I wanted to know why. Now, this scholar Capella wrote an article in German tracing the passion tones. And basically, what she did is she made this chart, and you'll see that the passion tones are derived from the three main roles of the passion story, right? So the evangelist, kind of the narrator, soliloquies, meaning dialogue that is said by someone who isn't Christ. So this would be like Pontius Pilate talking, or one of the disciples, Peter, saying that. So those would be soliloquies, or the crowd, the turba. And then finally, Christ, right? Now, within each of these three roles, there are all these passion tones. And the way that this developed is that, like on Palm Sunday, right? All the passion stories read aloud, right? Well, then what happened over centuries is that those readings became musical, and that there were little motivic things that you can see notated here that developed as people were reading the passion story. And eventually these became ritualized, and certain little musical melodic fragments became associated with different parts of the passion story. So we sing this when the evangelist is talking, is narrating. And then when Jesus asks a question, it goes like this. And these became, you know, over centuries, became kind of standardized and known. And so Capella really identifies these and says, this is what Lechner was doing. And that's really what makes Lechner's Passion so significant, is he took all this this centuries of recitation tones and integrates them into a 35-minute motet passion that if you didn't know, you would just say, oh, it sounds like beautiful Renaissance polyphony. But you don't realize that it's completely on this like wire framework of pre-existing material in these passion tones. That's what makes it so crazy cool, and how to see how it's composed, right? How it's working, right? So what I did in my modern edition is I identified all these passion tones, and then I put them in red and labeled them. So you'll see here, this line in the soprano part is the evangelist initial recitation tone, (1), right? And I tried to do it in an obtrusive way. But then this is saying, you know, Judas, though, the one who would betray him, right? So then you can tell that's a narration, right? That's the storyteller just saying what's happening. And if we go back to this chart, this is at the top, right? So it's A, B, C, and it goes on, and then A, C. Well, let's look here. A, B, C, and we're all on that. And then in the next measure, it would go A, C, right? So now you can sing this piece. You don't have to care about the passion tones, but if you did, you could actually see them, right? So that's kind of the overview of kind of the three things that I cared about, right? Making the piece both scholarly and accessible, making it really clear what is true to the 16th century source material, and then finally answering this question of how did Lechner use the passion tones, right? So that's a little bit about how to make a modern edition, right? So that even though we kind of all have sung a piece like the Talus, If Ye Love Me, remember, it didn't look like that to Talus, right? And so I hope this kind of maybe peels back the curtain on how that part book turns into something that would be more recognizable to any of us living in 2021 today. All right, that's I know there are a few questions in the chat. Let me see how far back they go. And I'll start here. Oh, let me go to Dale here. Are the oldest manuscripts kept in protective rare books rooms in libraries? And what do you have to do to access them? Yes, many of them are in libraries. Some have been digitized. I had to request from the library in Kassel to scan that and make it available to me. So that's how I did it. But I know some manuscripts are not accessible to scholars, or you have to have a letter from your sponsoring university or whatever to get access to them. But that's a very common dissertation in choral music, is to produce a modern edition. So a lot of my colleagues from Iowa would go to Italy for a summer and make a modern edition. And that's a good, valuable contribution to choral music, right? There's tons of music. I mean, you go to a library in Venice, there's tons of beautiful, beautiful music sitting in manuscript form that is just waiting for a scholar to come along and care about it enough to put it into a modern edition, which is no small task, but is definitely a real contribution. Let's see, to add to Dale's question, were you able to handle the books? Can't imagine they had them at Hardin. No, I did that edition all from scans from Stuttgart. So that's how I did it. Let's see, I note that you vertically aligned the whole notes. That's right, you know, as part of, you always want all the beats to line up, which the manuscript doesn't, right? It's very kind of disconcerting when you're looking at the part. It's not like their music doesn't line up at all. Let me see if I can actually find an example of that here. Go back to a page from the manuscript. So here, you'll notice just there are different words happening at the beginning of these lines, right? And you'll notice actually different spelling here. So the tenor spells eam, I-H-M, and then in the alto part, it's im, I-M, right? And then the bass is spelled differently. But the soprano has lecten before it. So they don't always line up, but a good modern edition would do that. Yes, Deb, I love your comment that, yes, the measures, you know, you don't really think about it when you're reading music, you're just reading along, but they really do, really matter in how we do it, and of course how we sing it. I don't know how in the Renaissance, how they rehearse things. I don't know. They must have been much more difficult. Evan, again, is there a peer review process, or is it up to the editor or judge by whether anyone uses it? That's a good question. The modern edition that I produced went through peer review and then went on to a publisher, which accepted it. So it'll be published. But there is a website called CPDL, Choral Public Domain Library, where people upload editions that they make, right? And it's all free, right? All of this music is long out of copyright. And so, you know, if I made an edition of If He Loved Me, I could put it on CPDL and people could download it and use it for free. And, you know, maybe they like the solution I come up with, or they look at any of the other, there are dozens of If He Loved Me editions on CPDL that they could check out and maybe pick a different one. But yes, mine went through a peer review process. Eileen, thank you. How long did this take? It took me about 2 years to do this, and it was pretty laborious work. You know, I kind of set a goal of trying to do 4 measures a day. I mean, it's very, very tedious work, and you got to be very careful, and you're kind of always you're always coming to a head with a decision to make. These are just, this one modern edition is kind of very idiosyncratic to me and what I wanted to do in it. And so it's very difficult. Like, you can see the spelling is all over, the syllabification's all over the place. And each time you got to stop and think about it and make sure you're consistent across the piece. And I think my modern edition turned out to be about 90 pages long. So it's 5 movements, you know, it took a long time, but, and I'm glad it's done. Do the passion tones occur in other voices? Yes, they occur all over. And there is some kind of characterization. The evangelist roles tend to be more in the soprano part, I think because they want that narration to be very prominently heard in the upper voice. Whereas like Christ dialogue is very much found in the bass part, right? So there is, it does imply some characterization that way. Sharon, has my modern edition been performed or recorded? It has not yet been performed or recorded, but I can't say, but I've got a lead on it. And I know the publisher would like to have a recording available with this edition. So I'll keep you posted on that. But there are some recordings online of the Lechner Passion if you're interested in hearing it. Does Lechner create more complex musical ideas from the passion tones, such as a fugue or canon? No, he doesn't, although there are occasional little imitative parts, but those tend to be more text painting than, you know, like a formal musical idea or a technique like canon or fugue. I know, Rick says, I know a choir that could perform a first recording of this. If CMS wants to do that would be fun. I'd be game. I have to admit, though, I'm a little bit ready to put this to bed after spending years writing a dissertation on it and years making a modern edition of it. It's kind of like, we're going to get this one over the hill and then maybe take a little break from Mr. Lechner. Well, I hope this has been a fun way to spend an hour or so tonight on a Monday evening, very windy Monday. And thanks for indulging me. I hope this was interesting to you, and it's just nice to talk to someone who cares a little bit about Renaissance music and making an edition. I do want to just a couple kind of housekeeping things before we have our moment of Zen tonight. First of all, I hope you'll join me next week when I'll be talking all about the choral music of Estonia. Estonia has a really rich choral tradition and has a very unique history. And choral music is very much part of their cultural identity and political identity even. So I'll be talking all about that, and we'll be listening to a lot of different kinds of Estonian music next week. So please plan to come back next week for that. And if you haven't done so, you can register for that using the Eventbrite link in the video description below. Thank you for supporting CMSU. You can do that by liking this video, subscribing to our channel, emailing this to a friend, watching previous episodes of CMSU. Just help us get the word out about this program. You can also donate to CMS to not only continue CMS University, but also help us as we move forward out of this pandemic. Thank you very much for all the generosity that you've given. Finally, our moment of Zen tonight is from, how could we not? I'm not, you know, I probably should play something from the Lechner Passion, but it doesn't quite fit the moment of Zen idea. So we're gonna listen to If You Love Me, which is, of course, by Thomas Tallis. Really just one of the most beautiful pieces. And it's kind of neat now that you've seen the manuscript, you've seen the handwriting, you know what it looked like to someone in the 16th century. You can maybe kind of picture that as you listen to this. I'm really proud of this recording that I'll be playing tonight, which is by Tenebrae, and it's really stunning. So enjoy If You Love Me. Thank you. Oh man, I'm sorry you all lost sound. That stinks. I'm sorry, but I'll post this in the Moment of Zen playlist and you can check it out. I don't know what's going on technology-wise tonight, but thanks for sticking with me. And again, check the CMS YouTube channel for the recording in the Moment of Zen playlist. My apologies. If you were wondering, they performed it in F major, by the way. All right. Thank you very much for joining me tonight. I hope you're doing well, and I'll look forward to seeing you next week for another session of CMS University. Until then, take care.